I want to say this morning, if God be for us, who can be against us? If God be for us, and I want you to open up your Bibles to the book of Romans chapter 8. I'm just going to read from verse 31 to 39. These very, very popular verses of Scripture. It says, what then shall we say to these things? See, things get around our lives and it's, what are you going to say? Are you going to say, well, God, you know, why didn't you do this and what? No, what are we going to say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. In other words, God doesn't bring any charge or anything against you. God justifies you. He wants to make it right, just as if you've never sinned. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded. What are you persuaded by today, friends? For I am persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers nor things present nor things to come nor height nor depth nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And everybody said, amen. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. You know, I believe that today there's a question that's in my heart, and I know in many, many people's hearts. But what stops this unstoppable, awesome power of God? This God that created the universe, this God that raised people from the dead, this God that spoke into people's lives, that is just so amazing, that today lives just as strong, just as powerful, doing great things thousands of years later on. Just because we in Australia may not be experiencing God's mighty outpouring power that's happening all over the world today. You know today that there is a move of the Spirit of God that's happening all over the world. They say that in Ethiopia some 80,000 people a month are giving their lives to Christ. Over in some of those darkest places, there are literally hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people that are coming to Christ through a supernatural move of God's power. What an amazing thing. Just because we might not be seeing this great outpouring of His Spirit doesn't mean it's not happening in many parts of the world. And as I was preparing this message, I was just getting started, and I just started to write down these words. It doesn't mean it's not happening, just because it's not happening to us. It's happening in many parts of the world today, right now. And then I wrote, I believe it's our time. How many people believe it's our time? I believe it's our time. And as I wrote those words, I believe God gave me a prophetic word. And this is what he said. Get ready, remove the hindrances, stand up and be strong. Let your voice be heard, rejoice greatly and seek the salvation of your God. It has begun. It has begun. Get ready. That's us. Get ready. I want to tell you, there's most surely, before God pours out His Spirit, before God does what He's about to do, there's always an outpouring of satanic wrath on the church. There's always that which tries to stop, bring hindrances, junk, people start to fight battles that they haven't fought for years. Things start coming back to attack us. But I want to tell you, friends, it's not God that brings a charge against you. It's God who justifies. It's the devil who comes like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. But it's not a time to sit back and lay down. It's a time to get ready. It's time to get ready. And that's why I believe that in our prayer meeting that we're going to start again this month, we're just going to concentrate on honoring and worshiping and allowing the presence of God and giving him all the glory. Because I believe as you worship God and as we begin to worship in spirit and in truth, that God's glory is going to come down. And what God will do is he'll anoint your life. And you'll become a carrier of something so dynamic and so powerful that all you'll have to do is, like Peter, his very shadow touched people and they were healed. Paul had such a mantle and an anointing on his life that they took aprons and handkerchiefs from his body and they put them on the sick and they put them on those that had demonic forces and they were totally delivered, set free. Amen. You see, you don't just get that out of a Kellogg's cornflakes packet. You don't get that out of, you know, perhaps I don't know what, but you get that out of meeting with God, coming under that Shekinah glory. And I believe that the next move of God is going to be the glory of God. The glory of God's going to come down. It's going to fill the house. It's going to fill. I want to tell you that people won't be able to stand because of the presence of God. Friend, what we need more than anything else is not another sermon, but we need the presence of God to come into our meetings in Jesus' name. How many people are hungry for the presence of God? See, if you're hungry, you'll get fed. If you're hungry, you get fed. If you're not hungry, nothing much happens. Nothing much happens. Nothing much happens at all. But get ready. Remove the hindrances. Stand up and be strong. Let your voice be heard. I believe it's a time to go out there and witness to the unsaved, witness to in the marketplace. Go out there and witness to people about who God is. And if you can't, you know, in your own strength, get a hold of that tape or whatever you call it, that clip. This man was not just talking to anybody. He was talking to the UN. He was talking to all the leaders of nations. And I loved it when he said, sirs, I give you Jesus. I know about you, but friend, we need to give Jesus to this world that we live in. We need to give Jesus to the Sunshine Coast. Because a lot of people have forgotten this Jesus who we serve. And I want to tell you, people need to be reminded of this God. Stand up and be strong. Let your voice be heard. Rejoice greatly and see the salvation of your God. It has begun. It has begun. I want to just continue from a little bit from last week. And some set of 78, 41, 42, it says, yes, again and again they tempted God. They limited the Holy One of Israel. They did not remember his power or his hand. The Bible there, that word power is translated hand. They did not understand or remember the hand of his provision that was stretched out towards them. Friend, the church, we've got to realize again that we're not here with our cap in our hand. We're not here begging God, God, would you please do something? You've got to remember again and again and again that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. To die for humanity that none would perish. It is God's desire that none would perish. And today we see just not caring, not really worrying or interested in the things of God. But friend, today, as you and I, as we remember, as we do what God wants us to do, we've got to go out there and do it. But friend, I want to remind you today that God's hand of provision is outstretched towards you. It's not saying, oh God, would you please? No, God wants more than anybody else on this planet to see a revival. God wants more than anybody else to see the sick healed. God wants more than anything else to see the nations of this world become the nations of our God. Why? Because he's a family. He's a father. He wants his people. He wants to gather them as a hen would gather her chicks. He wants to protect them. He wants to save them. He wants to deliver them from the works of the enemy. But people somehow or other uncaringly don't care. They're just running towards the enemy and lapping up all that he's offering them and denying and not understanding that God's hand is outstretched towards them. Really, they forgot how God delivered them out of bondage, how he turned the rivers into blood, how the swarms of flies came and started to harass the enemy. Frogs. They forgot God and God's ability to save them, set them free. In Luke chapter 9, I want you to have a look with me in Luke. Luke chapter 9. Amazing verses of scripture here. I'm going to read from verse 11. But when the multitude knew it, this is Jesus had left, when they knew it, they followed him and received them and spoke to them about the kingdom of God and healed those who had a need of healing. I want to say this again. Here's Jesus on his way, moving through. And as he's going on his journey, the people heard of it. And they followed him. In other words, hungry people. There's another story in the Bible where Jesus was going to Jericho or somewhere he's going. I don't know where he's going, to be honest with you. But he's going somewhere. And the people heard about it. And a great crowd followed him. Jesus, I know that he was on a mission. He was going somewhere to do something. And as he went, and this great crowd gathered around him, he saw Peter with his nets, and he went over and he said, "Peter, can I borrow your boat?" And he just went out a little bit and he shared the kingdom. He started to minister to these people. I want to tell you, hungry people get fed. Hungry people get fed. You know, a lot of Christians today might be sitting on the bank of whatever it is up there, watching the waves or something like that, and doing the family thing or whatever it might be. But I want to tell you, hungry people will get fed. Is it okay to say that? People that have got a hunger for the things after God, they're the ones that will get fed. And here we find this story here of this amazing story. And this crowd started to follow him. And he healed all those that had need of healing. And when the day began to wear away, the 12 came and said to him, "Send the multitude away that they may go into the surrounding towns and country and lodge and get provisions. For we are in a desert place here. We're in a dry place. We're in a place of no provision." And they didn't understand that they were in the place of the greatest provision. Sometimes we don't understand where we are today. You are standing right now in the greatest place of provision. You're in the house of God. You're lifting up your hands. You're worshiping God. And God wants to pour out His Spirit upon you. He's hungry. He wants to meet your needs. And here these people are saying, "We are in a deserted place here." And he said to them, "You give them something to eat." And they said, "We have no more than 5 loaves and 2 fishes, unless we go and buy food for all these people. At one stage there, one of the disciples said, "It's going to cost 200 denarii. That's a lot of money to feed 5,000 odd people." But the Bible said in that particular passage, but Jesus already knew what he was going to do. So there was about 5,000 men. And he said to his disciples, "Make them sit down in groups of 50. And we find here that he started to break the 5 loaves and the 2 fish. And looking up to heaven, he blessed and broke them and gave them to his disciples to set before the multitude. And they ate and they were filled, or they were satisfied. And 12 baskets were left over, 12 baskets of fragrance. Matthew chapter 16. If you have a look with me in Matthew chapter 16. It says, then the Pharisees and the Sadducees came and testing him, asked him that he would show them a sign from heaven. And he answered and said to them, "When it is evening, you say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, it will be foul weather today. for the sky is red and threatening. Hypocrites, you know how to discern the face of the sky, but you cannot discern the signs of the times. A wicked and adulterous generation seek after a sign, and no sign shall be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. Now here are the disciples, and they're with Jesus, and this bunch of Pharisees and Sadducees came to test Jesus. And obviously Jesus got a little bit upset. And as they came and he called them hypocrites, he started to speak to them like that. And I would imagine that if you're with somebody and they're having a shot at somebody, you know what I mean? You feel a little bit, oh, dear me. Poor old Neil's not having a good day today, you know? He's look at him, he's biting that bloke's head off, you know? But see, Jesus was discerning what was going on. He knew what was going on, that they were testing him. And you bunch of hypocrites. And so now the disciples, because they were human, they would have walked around and they would have said, man, Neil was cranky this morning, or Jesus was cranky this morning. Wonder what was wrong. Nancy must have cooked him bad breakfast or something. Yeah. Then they get in the boat and they look at each other and they've forgotten to take bread. And the human thing would have said, man, he's already cranky. We're really going to send him over now. We've got no bread. There's nothing to eat. And let's just have a look at it anyhow. Where am I? And it says, but the prophet of John, and he left them and departed. Now the disciples had come to the other side. They had forgotten to take bread. And then Jesus walks up to them and says, take heed and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. You see, what I believe the Spirit of God is saying here, and what I believe the Spirit of God is saying, is you need to be careful who you're listening to. You need to be careful. If you get beside people there that don't believe in the Holy Spirit, don't believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit, don't believe in healing, don't believe in deliverance, don't believe in all these sort of things, the leaven that they're talking about here is yeast. And when you put yeast into the dough, it just doesn't touch a little bit. It leavens the whole lump. And what he's saying is you've got to be careful of what you're listening to. You need to hear the Word of God. And if you're not sure about it, you need to make sure you don't just go to this one and that one. You need to go to the Master himself and say, God, will you help me? Will you please reveal this truth to me? Because I'm hearing all these sort of things that's going on. And if ever there's a day and an hour that there's so many voices, so many different opinions, so many different goodness knows what, friend, I want to tell you, we're living in a day when we need to hear what God's got to say. And I believe that's why the Bible says many times in the book of Revelation, he that hath an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit's saying. Because if we believe that we are in the end time, that's the book of Revelation. Because there are many voices and there are many things that are going on, many different philosophies and traditions that I believe that have to be challenged in Jesus' name. And take heed, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And they reasoned among themselves, saying, it is because we have taken no bread. That's why he's cranky with us, and he's got the overflow from these other fellows. They set him off this morning. They got him going, and it's continuing. Now we've forgotten bread, and he's cranky with us. It had nothing to do with bread. What was going on had nothing to do with bread, but what it had everything to do with is that they hadn't forgotten bread. They forgot who was with them. Yes. Friend, what's so easy at times when you're going through something is to forget who's with you. The King of Glory, amen. We are joint heirs. He said he would love us and care for us. You've got to remember who's with you. It's got nothing to do with bread. If we forget who's in the boat with us, if we forget who's the head of the church, if we forget who is the king that we worship and loving, friend, we will lose our vision, we will lose our hope, and all we will do is become another club with a bunch of doctrines and messages that just make excuses why we're failing. Well, I want to tell you, friends, that the reason we fail is we forget God. We forget Jesus, amen. We forget the Savior of the world, and I believe that's got to change. If you believe it with me, would you say amen? You see, the disciples have forgotten bread, but the Bible says that they had one loaf with them. Jesus fed 5,000 with five loaves. Surely he could feed 12 plus with one loaf? Hey? You think one loaf would have been more than enough? I believe, you know, the centurion that came to Jesus and said, hey, you don't have to come to my house. Just send your word only, and my servant will be healed. And we know that Jesus looked at this centurion because he said, I am one who is under authority. And I say to those that are under me, go, and they go. I say, come, and they come. And I know that you are the one, the master of sickness and disease, and all you've got to do is tell that thing to go, and it will go. And Jesus marveled. He said, I have not seen such faith in all of Israel. How would it be if the church of the living God started to give Jesus a few shocks and started to say, Lord, okay, all I know is greater is he that's within me than he that's within the world. All I know is that God, you love me and you care for me, and I'm not going to deny you. I'm going to give you all the praise and all the glory. What can separate us from the love of God? Nothing can separate us from the love of God. I believe he could do that. Mark chapter 8. Just have a look with me in the book of Mark. Mark chapter 8. It says here, now the disciples have forgotten to take bread, and they did not have more than one loaf with them in the boat. I just wanted to read that to you, so you, that all he had was one loaf in the boat. Satan, with our help. Everybody say, with our help. Satan, with our help, builds walls that stops the word of God penetrating into our innermost being. Satan, with our help, builds walls around our minds, around our emotions, to stop the word of God penetrating. See, I believe we need to see, we need to hear, and we need to remember. I see people surrounded by 10-pin Skittles. Is that what you call those things? Skittles, what I used to use as a kid. I don't know what they call 10-pin things, 10-pins. But I see people surrounded with 10-pins. Stopping the word of God, stopping them from going forward, stopping, and they're locked in this behind this wall. But I also see Jesus with the bowling ball in his hand, amen. And he's about ready to make a strike. How many people want God to make a strike around your life and knock those Skittles flying, amen? Knock down those walls that stop us. Knock down those walls that get in our way. See these things, these Skittles. I see people there like in a well, totally surrounded by a brick wall. God showed me once when I was a new Christian, young Christian, and had many, many hang-ups. Anybody else have a few hang-ups? Very, very shy, very, very insecure, full of inferiority, full of all that self stuff. And I remember praying one day and asking God, I don't want to be like this. You know what amazes me? Most Christians don't want to stay like they are. But until you come to the Lord and start saying, God, will you help me? God, will you reveal to me? Will you show me? And it wasn't necessarily a vision, but it was a feeling that I felt. And because I was a builder, I saw myself, the mortar with the blocks, and I was taking the block and I was putting water on and building this wall so secure around me. I left school when I was 13 years of age, and because of the lack of education and different things like that, I felt very, very insecure around people that had higher education. God had a sense of humor when he asked me to become the principal of the school. I said, God, you've got no idea what you're asking. You know, this is Neil down here. He said, I know. He said, but we're just about ready to put that bowling ball through a few walls that you've built. And as I was building this wall to protect myself, I looked over and Satan was my laborer. And you've got to see this, friend. Satan is your laborer. That's building those walls to stop you from becoming what God wants you to become, because he knows the potential in a church that's been set free and released. And here I am, downloading from God, and all of a sudden this song, like a wrecking ball. And I just see Jesus on that wrecking ball, coming down and smashing those wells and smashing those walls and breaking through. And you know, it's not an easy thing, but we've got to somehow or other say, God, will you come and smash the walls that I have built around my life to try to protect myself? Because my God, you want me to know that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And I want you to know that I became the principal of the school with a 96% average. Hallelujah. This is the first exam I've ever passed in my life. It might have been the first, but it was one of the few. Because God can do exceedingly abundantly above, amen, more than you could ever ask or think. You know, I believe that we can break the cycle. We can break the cycle that's in our lives. I believe that we can, if, you know, you might have built those walls, but we can break down the strongholds. We can break down those walls of petition. We can break down. Moses broke it down. Here's Moses in the backside of a desert, and there's a burning bush, and the bush starts to burn, and God starts to speak to him out of that thing. You think, my God, that'll be a miracle. That's amazing. If you did that, I would do it. No, I want to tell you, if you're still behind that wall, you will say exactly the same things, whether you have a visitation from Jesus or not, because something's got to change on the inside. Something's got to change around our lives. If it doesn't change, we're the same old, same old. Inferior, whatever else it has to be. It's got to come down. It's got to be smashed. It's got to be destroyed, amen. We've got to be bold so as we can go out there and speak the word of God with boldness. Moses was there and he started to make all these excuses. Because God said, I've seen the problems of my people. I've come down to deliver them. I've come down to set him free. And Moses was saying, good. And he said, I'm going to send you to the Pharaoh. He said, hang on. Woo, 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 woo. Now, you said you were going to do it. He said, I'm going to do it through you. See, you can tell God what to do all day, but he says, I want to do it through you. If you're praying those prayers, it's mostly because he's put it in your heart. But what you're doing is saying, but God, you do it. He's saying, no, it's just like, you know, hey, God, look, these people are hungry. These people are hungry. Send them away. He says, no, 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 no. I put that in your heart. You've seen that they're hungry. Why? Because I want you to do something about it. Oh, let's send them away. No, no, no. You give them something to eat. Friend, oh, Father, we want a revival. We want to see a move of God. Well, I want to tell you, you will be no move of God until you start moving. I wish I could say something better. It's the church that he wants to use, amen? The church triumphant. The church ruling and reigning with Jesus, amen? The world is yet to see the full release of the promise of the Holy Spirit put into the church. The church living in victory. not hiding behind a wall, not hiding behind this or that, but standing up and declaring. I want to tell you, friends, the walls will come down in Jesus' name. Like a wrecking ball, like a mighty rushing wind. God's strike men. That I want to tell you that. Oh, Rashaka Bundi Nipi Kalada Bodaraba. Oh, glory to God. Here's a bunch of guys just like us in an upper room. Didn't know whether it was what day it was. Scared stiff, most probably, because there was a lynch mob outside wanting to destroy their lives. They're in an upper room praying. I don't know what they were praying, but they were in one accord. God, you've got to help us. God, help us. God, do, you know, please, please, please. Like a mighty rushing wind. I want to tell you, that mighty rushing wind blew out every negative force, every bit of self-consciousness, every bit of whatever was junk in there. It blew it out in Jesus' name, and they came out of that place. They were no longer hiding behind that wall. They are no longer hiding in that upper room. They came out of that room, amen, and they went into the highways and the byways, and Peter stood up in the midst. He said, hey, these men are not drunk women as you suppose. But this is what the prophet Joel spoke about. This is a mighty outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Friend, I want to tell you, if you want to get some cobwebs blown out of your life, if you want to get some negative things blown out of your life, if you want to get all that inferiority and whatever else blown out of your life, I want to tell you, have an encounter with the mighty Holy Ghost. He will blow whatever it needs to be blown out of your life. Amen. I tell you what, he'll leave what's got to be left. It's like that man with his blood in Jesus' name. Like a mighty rushing wind. Like a mighty rushing wind, that wind blew and it shattered and it pushed and it smashed every work of the enemy. The Bible says that there's a natural man in 2 Corinthians 4:16. There's a natural man, there's an outward man and an inward man. The outward man is perishing, but there's an inward man that's being renewed day by day. My God, blow on this inward man. Come on, lift up your hands. Blow on this inward man in Jesus' name. Blow out the cobwebs, blow out the junk, blow out whatever's got to be blown out, my God. Fill us again with the Holy Spirit. Natural man that's got to die. I don't know about you, but I've lived long enough to know right now that this natural man in me rushes to the negative. Come on, can we be honest here today? Rushes to the negative. Something goes, oh, rushes to the negative. We've got to stop rushing to the negative. We've got to rush to Jesus, amen? We've got to come to Jesus, come to Jesus. I believe we can break that thing. Moses broke it. Gideon broke it. What did Gideon say? I can't, I can't, I can't. When I found out that I had to become the principal of the school, I said, God, you got no idea. You got to be joking. You have to be joking. I tried everything in the natural. I ran to the negative. I cannot do that. I can't do this, God. I could not do that. I wouldn't be able to do that. I tried every trick in the book. And every trick I tried felt flat. I even tried to get Bob Collard to be the principal. He said, it has to be the senior pastor. Almost made him senior pastor overnight. I can do anything to protect myself from exposure. I'm the only one that knows how stupid I am. I don't want everybody else to know it. I went to the school, principal school. I hid behind the pot plant because I was scared that they might ask me to do something. I was terrified. All the teachers were already in doing the exam, but the principals We were in a special meeting for half an hour. I said, go on, need all the time I can get. And we're in a meeting for half an hour extra. I got out there and this guy sitting beside me had already had stars. I almost dropped him. I got so angry with him. He was such a smarty. But I found that God's good. Amen. I became the principal for 3 years. I didn't know what to do. I didn't know what to do. So we just had assemblies. Alan Taylor was my school teacher. He didn't know what to do. I tell you what, a lot of those kids today are in leadership in churches all around the world. Amen. Amen. I can't. Gideon couldn't. I can't. I'm the least of my father's household. Disciples, did Peter deny Jesus? And then Peter said, I'm going fishing after they crucified him. And the rest said, we're coming with you. Unbelief is contagious. You get around people full of unbelief, you'll catch it. You need to get where people can somehow or other believe God. Fear is contagious. Fear, people full of fear. When we were first married, we lived in a haunted house. This house, I'm sure. But this old, old, old house. And there were two old, old, old ladies owned it. And they lived in a portion of it, and we lived in a portion of it. I think they were demon-possessed people. We knew not, we weren't even saved, didn't have a clue. But we're in this house. And because I'm a bit of a joker, knew Nancy, what Nancy was like in this house. She was scared stiff. But I only rented it because it had a big yard and I brought all the timber for my house and put it in the yard and I cut the house out in the yard and took it on my boat trailer to the house and just took what I could take, what I could put up for the day, and that was it. Little bit by little bit, we built the house. That's all we're, this old, old house. And we'd get to bed and turn the lights out, and it was black as anything. Eerie. And I'd say to Nancy, I'd say, what was that? And she'd say, what? I heard something. And, you know, within 3 minutes, I was just as scared as she was. I'm getting goosebumps on my arms now thinking about it. We were both sitting in bed with our eyes looking at the scared stiff. Fear is contagious. Sickness is contagious. Friend, we just got to somehow or other break some of the things there. We've got to remember the great things that God did for us. Jesus turned the water into wine. I want to tell you, he can turn our mourning into dancing, our sorrow into joy. I don't know about you, but I believe today that God before us, and if that prophetic word, which I believe God gave me, get ready, remove the hindrances, stand up and be strong, lift up your voice, be heard, rejoice greatly, and see the salvation of your God, it has begun. I don't know about you, but it's begun in me. Can I say that with all boldness and all whatever you want to call, I don't care whether you call it pride or arrogance, but I want to tell you there's something burning on the inside of me. There's an itch that I cannot scratch. There's something that's starting to boil and bubble up and excitement and enthusiasm. I'm not looking at what I see. I'm looking at what I know. And I know that there is a move of God that's starting to happen throughout the nation of Australia and that the Sunshine Coast is going to be touched. I don't know about you, but if you've got an itch you can't scratch, well, you're in the right company. And if you want to get an itch that you can't scratch, well, you just hang around long enough and you'll get it. Hey, friend, this altar's always open. If you're here today and something's touched your heart, you might want the fire in your belly. There's a gentleman came to church here last Sunday from somewhere. And he came out and he got such a touch from God. He was talking in tongues at the top of his voice. Power of God hit him, amen. Others were being touched. Light the fire again, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Would you raise your hand and say, light the fire again. Light the fire again, Jesus. Light the flames. Burn inside of me, my God. Burn in me, my God. River of life flows through me. Friend, we're not playing church in this place. If you want to play church, you come to the wrong place. We want to be the church. We want to be the church. God's talking to you this morning. You want to just slip out of your seat and say, I want that fire burning inside me. You might even already have a fire, but God, I want it to burst in the flame. All-consuming fire. Consume every negative thing in me. Break every stronghold around my life.